Welcome back, everybody. It's March Madness and it's Sweet 16 time. We've got four games on slate today. I'm talking once again with Ross Benjamin about underdog value. So with a limited slate, let's find out where there may be some underdog value. Ross, first and foremost, thanks for being on with us. You're doing nothing but producing. Let's break it down, my man. Let's get into it one game at a time and see if there is some value with the underdogs. And with that, I'll turn it over to you and we'll just go from there, my man.
You start with the Notre Dame and Wisconsin game, Mike. You know, I don't have a strong opinion in this game. We discussed this a couple days ago with our Sweet 16 video we did with the other four handicappers, good handicappers at SBRPicks.com. So, again, this is a game I'm going to personally stay away from. We've seen some money go to Notre Dame over the past 24 hours. They're currently at -1.5. Neither one of these teams, I don't believe, is going to have a legitimate chance to win in the regional title game against the winner of Indiana and North Carolina. I would stay away from this game. That would be my advice.
I couldn't agree more. And actually, yeah, Bodog right now, I just saw this 5 minutes ago, has Notre Dame at -2. So there definitely is some money being put on Notre Dame. What are your thoughts as far as coaching in that game? You've got an experienced coach against a Wisconsin coach that got thrown into the mix halfway through the season. Any thoughts on that and how that might, you know, have an impact on this game?
I don't see that being a big deal, Mike. I think that Gary Gard has done a terrific job since taking over for Bo Ryan. Let's not forget, he's been on the Wisconsin staff for 16 seasons now. He's brought up or tutored, I should say, by Bo Ryan. So there hasn't been a lot of change in terms of style of play for Wisconsin. No transition. And you could also make the case the guy's done a terrific job over the last half of the season if you look at the results. Mike Bray got his team to the Final Eight or Elite Eight last year. Really was close to knocking off an undefeated Kentucky team in the Elite Eight, and they have an opportunity to get to the Elite Eight again. Prior to that, you can't make a case that he's been an outstanding tournament coach. So I think this is pretty much dead even. Maybe you give a slight edge to Mike Bray in that regard.
Okay, that's very interesting, and I like that. I think that's a very good analysis. And, you know, I wonder, and I've asked you this before, Ross, is Bo Ryan somewhere scratching his head and going, what was I thinking? Or, you know, I really personally think that if he'd have known, you know, and had some high, you know, in hindsight's 20/20, but if he would have known his team would have gone this far, I don't think he would have stepped down.
My personal opinion, Mike, is it had nothing to do with his team or record. It's well documented what happened in that situation. I think the university respectfully said, I think you better resign out of respect. We don't want to have to fire you publicly and take your retirement and move on. I certainly believe that was the case, as opposed to, you know what, this isn't going to be a good year. Let me bail.
Okay, that's interesting, and I appreciate that insight. I didn't know that. We'll talk again off camera because I want to hear the whole story on that. All right, what's your thoughts on this?
Mike, before we go on, the story is he was having an affair with one of the secretaries in the athletic office, I believe.
Wow.
So it had a lot to do with that. Anyway, let's move on.
Yeah, my hat's off to him, though. The guy's, what, 78 years old? I'm just teasing. But had an affair with the secretary. Okay, Ross, we got Indiana and North Carolina. Break it down for us, my man.
Well, look, at North Carolina is an excellent basketball team. There's no two ways about it. Right now, you could certainly make the case them and Kansas are the teams to beat. But, you know, after watching Villanova and Oregon yesterday, I don't think it's as clear-cut as we all think. Anyway, look, at Indiana is an underrated rebounding team. Okay, they don't have the athleticism on their front line in North Carolina possessed, nor does anybody else in the country. But they have the capability of at least neutralizing North Carolina's huge advantage they have against most opponents. Thomas Bryant has to stay out of foul trouble for Indiana. Indiana is also one of the few teams in the country that could really match the quality depth of North Carolina as well. And, you know, I've said this on numerous occasions, Mike, and I'm going to say it again. The great equalizer for a college basketball underdog is the ability to hit three-point shots at a high percentage. And Indiana certainly qualifies in that regard. number 5 in the country at better than 40% conversion rate on their three-point attempts. Number 2 in the country in offensive field goal percentage. This is a team that can really shoot the basketball. I just think that this game is going to be much closer than a lot of people anticipate. I think there's some underdog value to be had here with the Indiana Hoosiers.
Wow, interesting breakdown. And yes, they are an excellent shooting team, and I think Yogi Ferrell's really going to step up today. Iowa State, they're getting 6.5 against a very, very solid defensive Virginia Cavalier team. What's your thoughts on that game?
I just don't see the underdog value here. I know it's very enticing to take a Big 12 team getting 6 or 6.5 points, but I'm not on board with that. I just think Iowa State, look at great individual talent. They have a few players that probably are going to be NBA players. Mm-hmm. Having said that, Virginia is collectively the better team. Iowa State is a perimeter oriented offense, very good shooting team. They're undersized in their interior. They're also very vulnerable on the defensive end. In Virginia, you look at their whole resume, Mike, and you look at their roster, and you look at their statistics. They have very few holes, if any, that you could poke at. Great defensively, good rebounding team, and also they shoot the ball awfully well. They can beat you in so many ways and very frustrating to play against. Methodical offensive style. And when they get the lead on you, they may be one of the toughest teams in the country to come back against. I do not like the underdog value in this contest.
Yeah, and I couldn't agree more. And my hat's off to Iowa State. I think they've done an admirable job. But again, you got a first-year coach. They went through a lot of changes in the offseason. And Virginia is just very, very, you know, just really coming together right now better than ever in the season. So I couldn't agree more on that one. And last and not least, Syracuse, last I looked, was getting 4.5 against Gonzaga. This is an 11 against a number 10. What are your thoughts on this game? Because obviously I think one of these teams, whoever wins this game, will shortly be going home afterwards.
That's quite a possibility, but hats off to both of them because they've been very impressive in their two opening round wins. You're looking at a Gonzaga team that just blew out a pretty good Seton Hall team and also blew out Utah. Syracuse destroyed Dayton, and then they faced a Middle Tennessee State team that you could say they got a lucky draw, but that's the same team that went wire to wire against Michigan State and was everybody's Cinderella darling, and Syracuse has absolutely annihilated them by 25 points. Now, having said all that, look, I think Syracuse being in the ACC and facing an ACC schedule and also a pretty tough non-conference slate that saw them win non-conference games against UConn and Texas A&M, I think that's going to pay dividends in this matchup. I'll go out on a limb and say neither one of these teams is going to win by a double-digit margin like they did in the first two rounds. I also think Syracuse's 2-3 vaunted zone, which is very unique the way they play it, is extremely hard to assimilate in a practice setting when preparing for them. And I think that's going to give Gonzaga much more difficulty than people appreciate. Also, this is a Syracuse team, Mike, that's playing with a chip on their shoulder. They took a lot of flack from the national media when they were invited into the tournament. Many people out there, many experts, thought they were unworthy of an NCAA tournament bid. Well, they're proving them wrong. And this is another case in which they can go out, get to the Elite Eight, and say, you know what? Here's my one finger that I salute to you.
I like that. And boy, did they salute it. Yeah, my hat is off. And Jim Boeheim at this stage, at this level, you know, he knows how to get his team ready. And that chip on the shoulder, oh boy, that could go a long way in any sport. So I like it. Okay, viewers, you heard it. You know, Ross possibly likes Indiana and possibly likes Syracuse and some underdog value. Sweet 16 is here, and we're looking forward to it. Ross, thanks so much for being back with us, my man. I wish you the best tonight. Beat your book and beat them hard.